share it for my thing.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Me too. I'll do that.
I'm so sorry.
It's very cold over there. Excuse me.
Yeah.
It's cold together.
Oh, over there it's cooler. You're
it's
right.
Warm right
yeah, here.
Here
it's warm.
This is just this is right in the spotlight.
Can't see.
Yeah.
So if you want to move over, you can see. In fact, my
we want to
get
more popular, more viewers, and that's why we are sharing the video, the live video.
So you don't selfie.
Yeah.
Hi to everybody on Facebook.
If you don't feel comfortable, you can sit over there if you want to.
Too late.
Really?
Yeah, but the camera
it's
loves
up
you,
to
actually.
You.
Yeah.
It's up to you.
You're glowing, too.
Of course. All right.
What am I doing?
I shared.
See, Luigi asked me to do this, but it's easy for him because he sits in the control room while the guys, but like when you're sitting
all right, I shared.
On the thing,
on the
it's
thing.
Tough.
Hi, everyone. Oh, you know, some people that asked, is this the radio show that you guys have on Facebook? No, it's a study group. Is this a radio show? Is it, what is that? Would you have this microphone? You have this.
We're working on it. On Friday, we're doing our first video podcast. So, and
this is
kind
of a
English.
Video podcast, kind of.
Kind of, but I mean, because this is just like, we're not really planning anything out. It's like just whatever happens, happens.
Except you guys can participate if you want with questions and comments. Okay.
So our sound sounds pretty good, I guess. All right, one second.
Okay, so while he gets ready to start, so this is study group, so we chat about what is in this book. What is Spiritism? So we are on the third chapter, The Priest. So we already discussed the dialogue between Allan Kardec and the critic, Allan Kardec, and the skeptic, and now with the priest.
Okay.
Ready?
So
okay.
Let's begin.
Okay.
I hate to ask if I can have my book back.
Well,
sorry,
I've been trying to hand it
yeah.
out.
Yeah, oh, I'm sorry. So I
you
can do it. The good thing is if you're here, you don't really, you probably won't need it. But if you're interested, we can always, anybody on Facebook too, if you contact us, we can send you a copy of what we're studying, you know, by a PDF. So this is the new millennium. So last week we talked about questions 4, 5, and 6, so today we're getting on to question 7. And last week we were really talking a lot about the differences and similarities between Spiritism and Christianity and some of the other religions. And so the conversation with Allan Kardec and the priest continues from there, where the priest says that he agrees that Spiritism is consistent with many of the great truths of Christianity, but that from a dogmatic standpoint, it contradicts a lot of things. So Allan Kardec says, you know, of course it does, basically. It's a science, it doesn't concern itself with dogma. So that kind of leads us to one of my first points I kind of wanted to bring up about dogma and religion. And I would say a lot of us are here, you know, arrive at Spiritism. I mean, I can't say for anybody else necessarily, but definitely for me that I grew up in a Christian household, but that I didn't like the dogma. And because of the dogma, I actually rejected like Christianity as a whole. Like everything, I said, I don't want anything to do with this. Like when people talk about Jesus, I said, I don't want to hear it. You know, because of like the dogma of the church, you know, and only really now that I can see that, you know, not to tie, you know, Jesus's message with the church's message and not to confuse the two of those together necessarily. I understand that now, but at the time for me it was like a big leap. So what I wanted to ask you guys how you feel about, you know, dogma and religion, or what do you think? What do you think necessarily about Spiritism and dogma. Do you think that there is any dogma in Spiritism, or in some of the Spiritists we've met, or how do you feel about that?
I'm not quite sure about what dogma is. I'm really not. I mean, the rites and rituals that are attended to in the Jewish religion, for example, my wife was so into that, that you know, like, you were really committing a sin if you didn't follow up on the...
Mm-hmm.
All the rules. And the rules.
And
the procedure.
So yep. Very important to her.
Mm-hmm.
And I always thought it was kind of nonsense. And here, you know, so here I become a rabbi, you know, and I'm still not interested in that. Jewish rites and rituals have no meaning to me at all. The basic idea is in Christianity, it's in Buddhism, it's in certainly in Spiritism. And but to me, the rites and rituals, I guess that's to me, is dogma.
Mm-hmm. You want to read the definition?
I can't
read this.
Dogma? You know, this is from Merriam-Webster. Dogma is a principle or set of principles laid down by an authority as incontrovertibly true.
Well,
so,
I mean,
oh boy.
So when the rites and rituals become incontrovertibly true, when the people start to follow it, it is as if, well, if they're doing this, they are pleasing God. Now give me a break. This is what it has nothing to do with it.
I think in the respect of supporting and appreciate that it exists in its own right and others follow that. It was created by humans as a structure. Let's just stop there. So it was created by humans as a structure. Now, maybe it's out of hand, but it was created by humans as a structure. It doesn't mean that it's absolute. What's absolute is the feeling that you have for the truth. That's what's absolute, right? That's what we're learning here about, you know, the difference between ill will and goodwill, right? So anyway, so I can appreciate that. And listen, this is coming from our 100-year-old genius guru. We say that in a just teasing, but we love Stan. He's very enlightened in our opinion, and we have a lot of respect for him. And considering that perspective, I think that's an eye-opener. I like the fact that spirituality exists without the dogmas, right? I'm free to not have to stand in line and turn sideways or whatever it may be. I was raised in the Catholic Church. I didn't mind the dogmas. That's what you did. I didn't want to disrespect my parents, and they showed me how to go. I was confirmed in the Catholic Church. But the fact that the structure is not necessary to feel and act with the love of God and the teachings of Jesus. There's not a structure. There's an action and feelings that support that, the way you do. Maybe the dogma, in my opinion, was necessary at the time, that it needed a structure, they needed some type of consistency to stay focused or walk through this process when you all get together. And I think maybe that's the origin of it. This is just an open opinion of possibly that could have been, but my feedback is, let it be, to each his own. Some people perform well in a structure, like children. Some people like to be free-flowing, like others that I know in my
exactly.
life, my walk of life.
Yeah.
So I think maybe it's good and necessary. And I'll stop there. So that's my initial feedback from that question.
Yeah, I think dogma really is a lot of the things that they say that you're not supposed to ask any questions. Like, you just accept what we tell you is the truth. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for me, I got to a certain age where, like, I had a lot of questions, you know, and I needed answers. And if you weren't going to give me an answer, and, like, I wasn't going to accept, like, just anything, you had to give me a good answer, you know. So that's kind of...
Within that group, that religion, that organization, dogma, those strict rules, and if you don't follow those rules, you're kind of maybe kicked out or you're excommunicated or whatever they do. But it leads to anti-Semitism, I think, some of it. Not all the times, but you have to relieve yourself from dogma and use it as a guide. These are just guides. Dogmas could be used as guides in terms of to make your own structure, to find out the real truth. Well, the truth from everyone's perspective is always correct, is always And dogma is it can be a good thing, but just use it as a guide and to start leading and teaching and except for following. Dogma is where you follow, and that's it. You're stuck, and it doesn't expand your mind, your experiences, asking questions is a beautiful thing. To ask questions about everything, to expand the knowledge, to go beyond your environment, to really reach out in terms of, don't take everything for face value. Explore it to yourself, find out the truth. Always search for truth.
I was thinking about what Scott said too, about like it might be good up to a certain point. I'm sorry. That even things, like I was just thinking about, for example, like the Catholic Church has a confession. Now, if you think about, like, every week I'm going to go spill my guts to somebody, I have to tell them everything I did, it might actually change, like, you might not do the same thing. I might think twice before I, you know, like cheat on somebody or do something like that, you know, if I have to go tell somebody. But then the flip side of it is that you have some people that think, like, I can do whatever I want as long as I tell the priest before I die, I'm cool, you know? It has a good side and a bad side, too, that you know, if you like take it the wrong way, where you just take it like with that full belief, you know, where you don't really have to be responsible for it. You know, it's like everything, you have to be responsible for what you do. So I'm sorry, I didn't mean it.
No problem. Well, what I really wanted to say was dogma, as far as strict principles and guidelines go, at what point in your spiritual walk, it's going to be a vehicle to propel you towards that direction, or give you an obstruction. Well, rites and rituals, like Mr. Stan mentioned earlier, you know, that could be used as a structure to help you get oriented with spirit. But if it becomes something that you depend on and you limit yourself to that, it becomes an obstruction. The key thing is to not exactly get to the point where in your walk where you're going, willing to be more expansive and basically be willing to grow. And if it involves shedding or putting aside those same dogmas that you once believed in, then that's what you should be committed to doing. But then again, it's up to the individual. I'm not saying, oh, well, these are rules. But that's basically right. Something that I think. Right.
Could it be, like, what do you think is a reincarnation is a dogma? What do you think? Is reincarnation a dogma?
It's basically like if we wanted to be like the devil's advocate, we could say that this is like the spiritist, because basically the entire spiritist philosophy is based on the idea that we have multiple lives, you know? So you kind of like, if you don't accept that, like you're never really gonna get anything out of spiritism, you know? But then, it's kind of tough, because actually when I found spiritism, if somebody asked me, people would talk about reincarnation, I'd be like, you know, I really don't know if I believe in that or not. You know, I really was like on the fence about the whole thing, but you know, I don't know how you guys feel about it. If you guys just always believe in reincarnation, or
you know, when you're in touch with nature and you look at nature, you can see everything reinventing itself down to the earth and comes back up, stars being reborn, the earth, everything is moving, everything is coming back, humans down, coming back. It's just, that's all reincarnation, everything being reborn.
But do you think reincarnation is a dogma?
I think it's the truth.
You think?
Yeah, I tell you, I was very much on the fence before I found out about spiritism.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I mean, it was just something that was there, you know, and but studying spiritism, reading the books, well, I mean, it just makes such good sense. Mm. I mean, I truly accept it as the truth now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I don't see that as dogma at all.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's just it's reasonable, and it just makes sense to me. And
I would like to be reincarnated. Do we have a choice?
Yeah.
You can go really deep into that philosophy.
I'd like to come back as like a male model or something.
Well,
sure,
some,
why not?
Some
male
choice.
Yeah.
Chippendale dancer.
You didn't hear that.
Some had choices. Andre Luiz, he decided and requested to stay and write books.
Sure.
In the spirit world, and he remains non-incarnated ever since.
Where do you think he went?
Reincarnation is a dogma?
Yeah.
No, and especially considering the definition for a dogma, the principles could be more or less subjective.
Because reincarnation is halfway there in a science, in Australian science. Ian Stevenson, there is a department of a perpetual department in the University of South Carolina. So there are scientists working on that, and it will be proved. So when reincarnation is in the mainstream science, then it's not going to be a dogma, or because it says that it's an idea that is laid down by a authority. It doesn't say what. It could it be that science could it be a authority?
The Catholic Church has taken reincarnation. I think they call it incarnation, where they say, yes, you're going to go to heaven or hell, and you're going to be your body, your physical body is going to be that, which I don't believe. I think you get reinvented. Your body goes back to the earth as soil, as minerals, as whatever the earth is, as light. And then you get, and just beautiful, we have a choice. The dogma within that is you don't have a choice. If you're good, if we're telling you good, you're going to go to heaven. Here's indulgence. And these are the dogmas using incarnation or reincarnation.
Right.
So it is dogmatized.
Right.
In a sense, and it shouldn't be.
If you go to the church and ask them, like, why do I have to believe this? If you ask too many questions, they'll pick you out.
Oh, trust me, I've been there in the Catholic school, and one day I asked because I asked the priest, one of my teachers, I asked that there was only Seth and only three kids three kids. And then one killed the other one, and then the third one went somewhere and got married. And I asked the priest, I was 12 years old, I said, with who? Because there was no with the monkey, with
he
who?
He must have had a sister, you know.
And then he looked at me and said, Sincha, wait for the next class outside.
Trouble.
I mean, the church split it so much, I guess Egyptians too, they mummified themselves. And the bishops and the priests and the popes, they're all mummified there in the Vatican. Their bodies are there in those tombs or whatever as you go across. It's kind of disgusting. Right? They're physical, and that's the belief that they're going to be somehow...
Yeah, resurrected.
Yeah. It's interesting. I'm not saying it's not true, but...
I want a new body.
Yeah, me too.
Reality too is that when we talk about dogma and spiritism, is that like if you were in the spiritist center, I mean, I can say at least at this center, and you got up in the middle of the lecture and said, I don't believe in reincarnation, nobody's going to like kick you out or excommunicate you or, you know, shun you and your family. Like, you know, I haven't seen a stoning in a spiritist center in a really long time. We might try to like persuade you to study spiritism and read the literature and all these things, and we might have to ask you some questions, because that's really where we kind of come to is with spiritism, is that the principle of reincarnation and multiple lives actually answers a lot of our fundamental questions that we have. So without it, like kind of like spiritism just doesn't really make any sense. Actually, what I'd like to do, I really like this one chapter. I don't know if somebody feels like reading for us, because you heard my voice enough tonight.
Do you what?
No.
Do you want to do
Cynthia?
It?
I'm Swarthmore.
Cynthia?
I'm good.
See this one? Is
which
there,
one?
How big is it tight?
which page is that?
My arms might not be long enough
which
to see.
Which page is that? It's T. The question.
120.
If you want to read it?
No.
Should we read?
120.
My book's a little different.
Up until where?
Right here?
That whole paragraph,
starting with the orange.
Okay. Spiritism is founded on the existence of an invisible world made up of incorporeal beings who populate space, and who are none other than the souls of those who used to live on the earth or on other spheres, where they left their material envelopes behind. We call these beings spirits. they surround us continuously, exerting a great influence on people without them even being aware of it. They play a very active role in the mental world, and up to a point in the physical world. Spiritism is therefore contained in nature, and we may say that, for a certain order of ideas, it is a power, just as electricity is a power from another point of view, and gravity from yet another. The phenomena whose source is the invisible world have in fact been produced throughout time. That is why the history of every culture mentions them. As with electricity, only in their ignorance did people attribute these phenomena to more or less rational causes and give free rein to their imaginations regarding them.
Thank you. So, I don't know. I like that paragraph. It kind of supports what we're talking about as far as like the backbone of spiritism is the idea of spirits and multiple lives.
When she was reading, I was thinking that there is a parallel world right here, and we are in the beginning of in this findings, the understanding of this dimension, just like the, actually I'm gonna steal a quote from Kardec, just like the world of bacteria and viruses, we're not found before the microscope. It's a whole new world was unveiled. And it is right here, but we don't see it. And because of microscope, now we see a lot of things that we were not able to see.
I wish I could unsee a few things.
Right? And, but it is always amazing. Every time I read a André Luiz book, one of the books that is dictated by a spirit, like I just finished one last night, it blows my mind to think, and it was talking, actually this book was talking about this, the influence of the spirits on us, and how they can create suggestions that sounds like our own suggestions, but they're not. And how they can get mixed up, and we follow, like we think it's our own ideas, and they're not, and all this. Sorry, Reggie, you want to say something?
Yeah, I think bringing dogma in, this dogma restricts your imagination to dream, to look for the invisible, to understand what you don't know. And I think everyone knows everything. It's just the dogma kind of restricts you. You're that narrow minds you, in a sense, from that knowing of what your essence is. Is it this body? I think it is.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the physical world and the invisible
mm-hmm.
world.
Mm-hmm.
Oxygen is visible and invisible, but it's part of consciousness, which is another realm too. And what you find out is all these words, they mean all the same. Spiritism, consciousness, love, it's all the same. They're just different vibrations, different words. And once you find the simplicity of the whole thing, it's just life is so much easier to live. You're able to love so much easier. All the dogma and the stuff bringing you down seems like it just restricts you from that
right.
flow of your essence.
Yeah. You said something really cool that we human beings, we are always expecting something so special to happen or the phenomena to find out more about life, and we forget about the basic and the spiritual life, what we need to relearn.
You have to unlearn what you've been taught, or reevaluate what you've been taught.
Yes.
And realize everything you've been taught, maybe it's not, you know, there's a different realm of understanding. That's where spiritism slowly introduces you without getting you, because people will go crazy.
Yeah.
Because you've been taught one thing and you just now, it's not what that reality is. And it's
like
it's a scary realm to be in.
It's like the beginner's mind. They always say you should cultivate a beginner's mind. So every time you like look at something, you're looking at it with fresh eyes, trying to let go of like, you know, our ingrained,
yeah.
you know, the things we've learned, you know. Like even, I think that was a Paul McCartney was saying, like, every time he picks up his guitar, he tries to like forget how to play guitar. He needs to, I'm probably quoting the wrong guy.
Or Lennon, imagine, that song Imagine there's no religion, imagine there's no dogma, imagine.
Hmm.
I think that we will get there. Again, going back, I think this is not something I'm reading, but we all know structure is necessary at some point. And I think all that will evolve. Humans created that, right? It doesn't mean it was perfect. That could have been an error the whole time, right? So, but it does exist. And I like the way you put it. You know, it can be a benefit or it can be a restriction. Use the word, use a different word, but
a vehicle obstruction.
Or obstruction, and I think we all get that. I think over time we're already seeing. If you want to take a couple observations, we're already seeing this as, let's just use the word modern, right? Things are becoming more and more modernized, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so everything's adapting, just like we are adjusting a business or a neighborhood or a technology. I don't know, 20 years ago, I think I mentioned this before, actually, it just popped back in my head. So we're in high school or college, and, you know, this is the church. We're going to this other church, this new church. What's the big deal about that? Oh, it's music, and everybody's having fun. So now, oh, we're going to go to the fun church, right? I guess, you know, it was like, I don't know, this old structure and the dogmas of that one. Now, these are young people, and they have these new energies. So there's a new church formed, and we're having fun and yelling and you know, singing, and the singing, like the high mass, for example, you know, you go, I was raised Christian, so the 12 o'clock mass is longer. There's a lot more singing, you know, they got the choir, and everybody's doing their thing. And so my parents liked to go to that. I don't know. So that's what we did. So I guess they thought maybe we could sit still a little bit longer. I don't know. But again, the point is, you know, everything's evolving. Right, and maybe it was just the way it was created then, and it kind of carries on. But if you look and observe, even those dogmas may be adapting a little bit. Maybe they're a little slow. But I agree with all of this. It can be limiting. It can be enlightening. It depends on your point of view at that moment in time for that individual.
Exactly.
I think Spiritism helps show all of that. And I think that's the beauty of what this is, right? You know,
and always remind
me. I mean, I'm wearing shorts to a study group, right?
Yeah.
I never wear shorts to a church ever. Why would you know? So this is a whole new world for me. I mean, I'm in a center. I probably wouldn't wear the shorts into the other area, but and this is my own dogmas that I had. That's just not what you do, right?
I was watching a movie. They were talking
what
about
what I wanted
it was,
to do.
It was an old movie, and they were saying something about a girl like. They're like, oh, she showed her ankles, and they were like, oh my, like, you know. Like,
I was like,
I can't imagine that.
That's
like,
suppressing sexuality.
That was like
that
a
whole
big,
round.
So things are growing.
It's a repressive sexuality, and it's horrible. It's horrible.
We're evolving. I just wanted to finish, right? So we're all evolving, we're modernizing, we're being more open, including me, wearing shorts into a church.
I got
your sexy legs.
But it's a real benefit to allow it to be open. And I think the dogma, the
I
absence of dogma
helps
everyone.
I think you're a priest in the last
everyone.
Incarnation.
Yeah.
I think you're a bishop or a priest, some high.
Could be.
I know so many priests have really, from the Catholic faith, when I was Catholic, and just so many beautiful people.
Uh-huh.
And they just, they want to express their sexuality. So they have to drop out of the priesthood. They're excommunicated. Banished to hell for eternity. I've heard these things, and I said, "There's something wrong here." They're getting married and they're having children. It's wonderful to have that, to have a priest do that, going to a different who accept that. It just, you know, it just seems like
maybe I should become a priest.
Yeah.
Yeah, maybe you should.
It's been a slow
or
none. It's been a slow year.
We still want to say
something.
Oh, I was a priest.
So you're wondering why? What kind of group you're in?
I was a Catholic.
A crazy group.
Oh, is Stanley, you were a Catholic?
Priest.
Priest.
Yes. And I've been told that. I don't remember that.
I see.
Oh, in the
prior incarnation.
Yeah.
I
cool.
see.
But
very light.
That's really strange. Anyway.
Not that strange.
To me, religion, the word itself is to relegate, to reconnect us to God. Now, the religion is there to so that you can find faith, okay? And it seems to get in the way of finding faith. I mean, what is that faith? The faith is that we have a spirit inside of us that we have to get reconnected to.
Mm-hmm.
And when we can reconnect, that's the true religion, to be reconnected to that spirit that's inside of us. Now, I have been spiritual for many, many years. In fact, my books, my writing, and my lectures were always spiritual. And this is before I came to Spiritism. And I thought, gee, what I was saying was right. I'm really home here. And not only that, they've taken me even further than I have. I mean, I'm very aware of my spirit. And it's my spirit that does my writing. And it's different than Stanley. You know, in fact, if you read my book, there's Stanley talking and he's asking. He's asking that spirit that I call the Wizard of Ears, and the wizard answers those questions, and they are invariably right. And that everybody that reads it, you know, they like that.
Before you got into this knowledge, this movement, this Spiritism, did you find any other segment that could explain what was going on?
No. Spiritism explained to me what I was experiencing.
Yeah.
I'm so glad to be here. This is just a real boon to me at this age. You know?
That leads us into where I was going to try to take us next. I'm trying to find the exact quote where it says
it. Would.
But what Alan Kardec says is that Spiritism has shed light on questions formerly insolvable. I'm trying to find that. It's got to be. I'm looking at the one page as well. Our translation are a little bit different.
Translation is different,
yes.
Insolvable.
It shed light on multiple formerly insolvable or misunderstood. So its true character is that, therefore, that of a science and not of a religion. And the proof is that it counts among its adherents people of all faiths who do not have to renounce their convictions because of it. But what I wanted to ask about that quote. About shedding light on questions that were unsolvable, like for you guys that have been here for a while, I'm sorry, because what I want to ask is about what questions did you have, or maybe what questions do you have that Spiritism has like shed a new light on?
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, I just said, you know what I thought about. Anyway, religion has now become to me, its substitute has become for many people a substitute for its true goal. In other words, the dogma replaces the relegating and finding that God that's within inside of us. So just follow the dogma and then you don't have to do that. Who replaced it?
Makes sense.
And it's caused a lot of destruction as a result of that. I take a look at the Muslim religion, you know, the Shiites and the Sunnis, over some dogma thing, you know.
Protestants, Catholics,
each other.
I know.
It's
silly.
One thing that came to mind for me with your question, Steve, in the Kardec book, the Gospel, there's feedback that talks about part of Jesus' teachings, in the way the words, the language, the nomenclature, relative to the time.
Nomenclature.
I'll try
it
harder. Keep going.
Big word.
I try even harder.
It was relative to the time. Thank you. Okay. I'll see if I can come up with some more. And that modern day's interpretation of that doesn't fit. As part of Spiritism, it can even help us apply that same principle, like to the dogmas, for example. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if we read some of these parables, right, mm-hmm. and this was from thousands of years ago, you might interpret it literally, and you won't understand the true meaning of that, because we didn't live back then. We didn't understand the dynamics of what the world was, and the people were, and their level of education, level of thinking, and this whole aspect of the culture. And it says clearly in the book about that. So there's some study that you can do in that book, reading. Remember, you don't read that book, you study it, just like all the others. But it's quite profound when you go, wow, yeah, I didn't really get that. So now it's an adjustment. Spiritism and helped me creating an enlightenment of the old messages that need to be reinterpreted for modern day to understand the true meaning. And so
sounds a little complicated.
It is. Don't ask me to say that again.
It's actually pretty simple. But, it is. Well, it's more simple.
It's actually pretty simple.
Yeah,
pretty
simple.
So I think part of what I just picked up on, and that's kind of where my mind took me, is that you know, helps the spirit system helps you reassess things you've already learned, and to help find true meaning and deeper meaning. Mm-hmm. And the dogma is not helping you get there. About to bring the dogma back in, but I like the fact that you know, it's an extension of, and I'll kind of stop there because I can keep going, but it's an extension of what was, but let's continue to look for depth and understanding, because it exists, and it, these the teachings of Spiritism gives us the tools and the ideas and the kind of the focus to kind of dig deeper.
Really
get those
what,
understandings.
What I really want to know is, though, specifically, like, for you guys, like, what questions did you, like, come here with? Like, let me give you, a really personal example that, like, I'm a cancer survivor, and I always wondered, like, why did I get cancer? Like, nobody in my family has it. It's not genetic. It's nothing. Like why did I, like, when I turned 14, like, I started showing symptoms of cancer, you know, like why? You know, it just doesn't make sense. And like, because of Spiritism, I can't tell you exactly why, but I can, like, I have, like, a good idea. It could be, like, a couple of things, you know, like, you know, I could be expiating some old trial. It could have been, like, some kind of disease that I carried in my spirit for the last life. It could be, like, because of a moral problem. Maybe I was, like, a murderer in a past life or, you know, something like that, you know, or it could be just that I'm trying to, like in this life was trying to cleanse, or I might have just asked to have cancer as a trial, so like that I could overcome it, you know. Like I, you know, I'm not sure it's exactly why, but at least I have some kind of idea, and actually, the idea that it doesn't really matter. Like, what really matters to me is that I overcame it, and then I'm going to move forward with my life. So that's like one thing for me that like Spiritism has really helped me to like get some kind of an idea. Because ask anybody before, and they'd give me all kinds of different. Everybody would have their own opinion. Like, oh, they call it a shamanic death, and you, it's like a snake shedding its skin, and, you know,
well,
tell me all these, but
it seems like, I've studied nutrition and everything, and just to keep it on the simple side, is when you distance yourself, and it seems like dogma, the rules, regulation, propaganda, take you away from your essence, nature, the universe, consciousness. Once you take away from that, you lose that perfection, you lose that. So, which is basically when perfection is nature, is raw in nature. When you don't connect with that or consume it or surround yourself with it, which is processed foods, processed material, I mean, going green, that whole concept is kind of that realm, you tend to lose that perfection. And once you get back into that, you can gain that perfection. Or you lose your body, then you lose your senses, everything, what do you have? Then you get reinvented with perfection again, as a baby, or as a, and that baby doesn't have the constructs of nature. It becomes again. It doesn't have that perfection in it. It will have a defect or a birth defect or autism or something like that. But it all relates to those constructs of nature, and that's my realm of understanding perfection and nature and universe is perfect. Again, the dogma and everything tells we're imperfect. We have original sin. We have. There's negativity out there. There's wars. Everything is predestined and for death and everything. And it's those concepts have to be reinvented, reimagined, and retaught. And it's a scary realm, but it can be rewarding. Once you get into that realm, those fears go away. Because the fear of getting disease, you know, the fear of I'm going to die, the fear I'm going to go to hell. Once you get over that stuff, man, life is so much easier to live. And the new lives are easier to live. The understanding, it's pretty cool.
Well, to answer your question, I actually have a question when I came here. What exactly is mediumship? What is my place in this world, considering that everybody is a medium or has the potential to be a medium? What's my divine purpose? Do I have more than one divine purpose? What was my past life? Those are those questions I have that I've went through, especially since I left the church. I kind of denounced Christianity for a bit and was kind of doing my own thing, doing my own research, and, you know, I found that the principles of spiritism and divine metaphysics are what most correlate with my soul. Of course, I go to a church now, but it's not a church in a traditional sense. But ever since I got back into, you know, practicing spirituality, those are the questions that I've had, and I haven't really found an answer for them yet.
Those are wonderful questions.
Keep searching.
And you will.
You'll find them.
Because that's what you want.
Yeah. And by the way, I was going to suggest when we finish this book, we go to a very small book that is called What is Mediumship? Mm. All about mediumship. It's a very tiny book, but it got all the questions about mediumship, and it's a beautiful book from a great researcher, Brazilian researcher. He used to be a journalist, very well known in Brazil. It's a wonderful man. I was going to suggest that. But
we'll have to ask the mentors.
Stick around, because...
What's the definition of a medium, or mediumship? In terms of
the medium is the one that is in the middle.
Connecting you to your essence, to your true purpose?
The one that it's like a reporter, or it's like a cell phone, is the one that is in the middle. It's the medium.
Spirits in our physical world.
Okay.
But it comes from that word.
But
it's the one that...
There's a lot of different kinds of
skills. I wouldn't say any definition like he's saying, because there are a lot of types of mediumship.
Like a teacher, there's a whole bunch of different types.
There are a lot. And you know, it's
communication was a general word, but...
It's a very complex.
I'm
but
just trying to make it general.
The medium is just the one that is in the middle of something. So in the middle of the spiritual realm to
intermediary
between
the two worlds.
The material.
It's helping people connect between those two worlds to understand
the
between those two worlds.
Yeah.
Or the medium is wandering between those two worlds.
Yeah, there. It's fascinating,
yeah.
But we need to go into mediumship because it's. I wouldn't be able to say with just a few words. That's why I didn't answer all the questions.
Oh, that's okay.
But those are beautiful questions, let me tell you.
Yeah, the whole idea that mediumship, or, you know, because if you look at the Bible, I don't know how much you talk about the Bible in here or not, but basically it's full of examples of prophets.
Absolutely. Prophets were mediums.
Seers who were actually mediums. In the
yes.
church is medium and psychic
no.
and things. It's kind of like
prophets were mediums.
Basically,
taboo stuff.
Like we're all
natural,
no
basic
mediums. The idea that mediumship is only preserved for those who are pure, perfect, or anything like that is a thing that I reject.
Yeah.
And I believe that everybody.
And that's why we have people from everywhere that come to the Spiritist Center, because mediumship does not belong to Spiritism. Mediumship is a natural faculty of the spirit. Everybody, everywhere, you will find different types of mediums. And it doesn't matter if you are rich or poor, if you are very smart or not. Doesn't matter. That's inherent from the spirit, and this
physical,
it will depend.
And the physical body.
And the physical body. So we are all, but in different levels, and we will see that. So I'll bring the book. It's because I'm in the middle of moving to different houses. But I'll bring the book, and if you guys are interested, after this one, we can go into mediumship. It's a small one, before we go to the Allan Kardec one, because there is a...
So do you...
This one,
9:30. No.
This
one? He always goes into our time, the Spirit's book, but he's supposed to be done already.
Yeah, I was going
to
say, like, we
do one question.
It's 8:50 now, so, I mean, if anybody has anything that they, any burning desires, they have to say. But otherwise, I mean, that's a great question. You're in the right place.
Yeah.
I'd like to give her a little more... Just a little piece that...
I don't think so.
Hold
no.
on.
Please
you
stop.
Will find your answers, because you're interested in that. You can ask your own spirit, even before you go to bed, help me learn a little bit more tonight while I sleep. These are things you can start your process. And in terms of mediumship, everybody has different levels of sensitivity. It's all part of your divine plan and what you are intended to do in this incarnation and what level those sensitivities may be,
what would develop. What would Alan Kardec say?
So you can learn.
What would Jesus do?
We just started with the Spirit's book, so it's the next. It's the next thing we're gonna do is the go through, and actually I'll ask you to read it after you finish.
So we basically talked about questions 7 and 8, so we'll leave 9 for next week. I have a couple of things I want to talk about, and then we'll just do 9, 10, 11, whatever next week. There's 20 questions in this chapter, so thank you guys for a great discussion.
Wow, thank you.
I mean, we still have, I guess we'll still leave, I'll leave Facebook on, because
okay, all right.
So without any further ado, let's talk about the Spirit's book.
And let me just say to the Facebook guys, we're going to have a magnetism workshop, and we're going to be talking about healing and teachings, not only with theory, but practice, so you can learn how to balance your chakras, how to understand the symptoms and feelings of your body, and to work with people on healing. You like that? Light workers out there? Come, it's going to be on July 22nd, 23rd. It's going to be a Saturday and Sunday from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. And the contribution is only $30 for both days, because we are going to have food, breakfast, lunch, and afternoon break. You don't have to figure out where to go to eat. You can stick around and stay with us all day long. I'll be here. I hope you come. And if you have any questions, get in touch with us, our Facebook page.
Broward Spirit Society Facebook page. We have a WhatsApp group. If you need the material that we're studying, join our WhatsApp group or contact Steve McPherson or Cynthia Cavalcanti, and we'll definitely add you.
Impressive.
You know, we have the PDF copy of the book available.
Let us know.
Also have Tuesday night, 7 p.m. here at Broward Spirit Society. We have meditation, bathing.
Thank you.
Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. here, I'm sorry, 8:15 p.m. on Wednesday nights, we have the English lectures, which are amazing most of the time.
Who's lecturing this week?
Yeah, that's tomorrow.
Tomorrow we have the natural laws with the Yonara. Mm-hmm.
Oh. I hear it's going to be a scorcher.
Natural laws of the universe?
The natural laws, yes.
You never know what she's really going to talk about. So.
That's me. I always do tricky titles, and I never talk about.
I guess I'll close down. We'll end our broadcast now. So goodbye, Facebook. It's been real.